So with my little grandchildren, it can be a bit challenging, particularly when they were little. Now, for some of you who know how their mind thinks, you want their buy-in. You want to influence them to agree with you that it's, hey, time for bed, or let's go ahead and pick up your toys. And you can see the little their mind, the wheels are churning, aren't they? They're going round and round. But when you get their support, that big old smile comes on their face, and they're on board with you all the way. Well, in some ways, it's not too different than when they grow up. Today, I had a work call I needed to make, and it was uncomfortable at first, knowing and just trusting I had that influence, that connection. So I was prayed up before I got on the call. So let's backtrack for a minute there. It happened on Friday. I was asked to coordinate a conference call so we can select. I work for an organization. I help with the recognition of individuals. And so I was working with this chief judge and trying to set up a conference call. So I sent the email off, and pretty soon I got a phone call from someone who works in that circuit and said, "Oh, we just canceled the conference." I'm like, "Oh, but go ahead. Anyway, you might hear from the chief judge, but don't worry about it. Everything will be fine." But when I did hear from the chief judge that afternoon, or later that evening, I should say, she wasn't exactly on board with this. She's brand new to this position and had a lot of questions. And so I made myself available, and she said, "Well, I'm free on Monday." So Monday afternoon, I called just as she asked, but it was by faith. And that's what I'm going to talk on, the power of favor. By faith, I just jumped in on the call and started talking about how great, very upbeat and positive, how wonderful it is to recognize these individuals and what an impact it has. And I just went down some of the principles we're going to talk on tonight. And pretty soon, she started to open up because I've never met her, and her guard was up, first time in this role and position, and a lot of uncertainty. And then I found out she was a brand new grandmother. And so we talked about commonality, areas in which we could connect on. And pretty soon she says, "Well, I think this could work. Can we hold off?" And pretty soon we came up with a plan that I know I can work with my people, and she could work with her people. Tonight, I want to talk about that power of favor, because we're all faced with opportunities to navigate through life and to get the buy-in and support from other people. And there is promises from God's word that we flow in that power of favor. But how do you release it? Well, we're going to talk briefly on just how that works, because everywhere you go, you have the advantage. Come on, my friend, you have the divine empowerment and the power of favor that is that key to open up just the right doors before you. I love this promise in Psalms 5:12 that says, "The Lord, how wonderfully you bless the righteous. Your favor wraps," come on now, "it wraps around each one and covers us under the canopy of kindness and joy." God's favor, it wraps around about us. It's this canopy of kindness and joy. We have that divine favor working on our behalf. He promises to open up doors that no man can shut. But sometimes we have to be in that position, right? By faith, we step out, we're bold, we're courageous. We may not see the answer, but we see a God who says he's got it. And as we commit it to him, he will bring it to pass. That was that uncharted waters I felt like today on that call. And pretty soon, I could see the walls starting to come down. I began to see us have a dialogue that achieved an outcome, a process that would allow us to meet the goal and the purpose for what this award stands for. All of us, we have opportunities to flow in that divine favor, to know that his canopy, that favor that he wraps around us, that canopy, what does it do? It's that canopy of kindness and joy. We can have joy in our future. We can flow with this divine love and encouragement, knowing that, hey, God's for us, who can be against us? Well, let's get started in what I want to talk about more specifically. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would give us ears to hear. Lord, you have plans for us that are far over and above all that we could hope, dare, or imagine. But you have promised that the plans that you have for us, Lord, you are making them clear and known, that you are giving us the influence, the opportunity to fulfill your purpose. And to do that, well, the just shall live by faith. And so tonight, as we unpack that truth, that power of favor, that divine favor, may it stir up the ability to be confident in the life, in the purpose, and in the direction, the promptings that you're sending us into. Sometimes it's uncharted, sometimes it's uncertain, but we have a God who gives us a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. Father, I thank you and praise you for all these things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So my first thing was this influence that we can all walk in, this divine favor. But what is influence? Influence is your capacity to have an effect on possibly someone's character, their development, behavior. As I was mentioning about our grandchildren and trying to navigate with them as they're young. But hey, how about when my children were teenagers? Now that was interesting, wasn't it? To be that proper influence in their life. And then we have family, there's friends, there's communities. We're surrounded by individuals that God wants us to have an impact. In fact, I enjoy Matthew where it talks about how we're a light that's set on a hill and that we are salt to this world around us. We are light, aren't we? And to expose God's colors and his plan and purpose, which is for good and not evil. Proverbs 12:26 says that those who live right, they are good guides for those who follow. And wrongdoers, they will steer their friends down the wrong path. We are influencers, whether we know it or not. You know, I've mentioned this before. I'll be doing something in the kitchen and cleaning the counter. And when my grandchildren were little, pretty soon I saw them and they're cleaning the counter, right? They might not have the cloth I have, but they're finding their shirt and they're cleaning along because we're influencers. People are watching us. But like Proverbs says, we can be an influencer for good. And we can be good guides that people can follow. And we're to be examples of Christ and reflection of him. Or we could be a bad influence that will not honor his name. Influence, it's largely about causing people to say yes to your viewpoint, your request, your idea. When I'm in the workplace, I might not have the title, but I've earned the respect among my coworkers that when I say something, particularly to our executive director, I have her ear. For all of us, time is short. We have responsibilities that God has laid on our heart. And we need with that influence to bring about that truth that God is stirring and awakening in us. We have the power of divine favor. And we need to understand it's real, it's there, and to flow and operate in it. So tonight, I want to talk about a few key habits that will transform your ability to get that yes. Whether you want to be hired for a job or generate interest in a project or get the team on board with your idea. Whatever it is that you find yourself faced with today, tonight I pray that what those points are that we cover, that they will be an inspiration for you and will stir up a confident assurance that you've got this. So the first habit is showing concern for those around you. You know, it sounds almost too simple, but it's the simple fact that caring leads to influence. Philippians 2:4 says, abandon every display of selfishness. Possess a greater concern for what matters for others except for your own interest. You know, all the studies as it identifies what your strengths are. You know, it's interesting that one of the number one characteristics for a leader, it might surprise you, but it's having love and care for other people. How about that? So when you flow in that authentic concern and care, you build a connection. And pretty soon that individual wants to get on board with you because you care about what they care about. And I find this scripture interesting in Philippians, where it reminds us to have a greater concern for what matters for others. You know, we're to be about God's business. And isn't that what Jesus did? He put others before himself. Sometimes he would be going down somewhere with an intent to go in that direction. And yet someone would stop him. And he was concerned at the moment with that person, making sure that their needs were met. Or how about when he was in this home that was crowded with the religious leaders and these friends who carried someone who was unable to walk? They couldn't get in through the door. So what do? They open up the ceiling of that room and they lower very carefully their friend so that Jesus himself can, at that point, stop what he was doing and connect with that individual who ultimately picked up his mat and walked out that door. You and I, as we have that concern for those around us, we will build an influence and have an impact and flow in that divine favor that God has called each of us to bring as a shining light to the world around us. So if you want influence, if you want that ability to connect with a group or even an individual, stop and ask yourself, have I connected with them by showing my care, my concern for the things that matter most for them? You know, seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, all things are added unto you. When we put ourselves positionally seeking God, he gives us a heart of compassion, authentic love, sympathy, compassion for others. And when we do, there's a connection that happens. Maybe that connection is to be the leader that God's called you to be. Maybe it's to be an influencer in your family who's at one time was so full of discord and strife, but God has stirred on your heart as you intercede and get on your face before him to declare peace to the storm of that family situation. I want to encourage you tonight, you are an influencer. You flow in the power of God's divine favor. And you can shift the circumstances of even the family dynamics that you might be experiencing in your home or in the community that you live in. But you are the head. You are not the tail. You are above. You are not beneath. You are blessed as you go in and blessed as you go out, because you are hiding his word in your heart and you are choosing to not be hearers but doers of what he has commanded you to do. And that is to love others and to let that love be seen, that those acts of kindness and goodness to be experienced by other people. You know, people enjoy your words, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but what they value more is your acts of kindness. So love speaks, It speaks powerfully. Love is action, and love will influence others. 1 John 3:18, dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show truth by our actions. When you make time to listen, make time to stop in the busyness of what you have on your plate, to have a conversation, or maybe while you're there, God is stirring on your heart to call someone or send a note or a text to an individual, or more importantly, to pray and to stand in the gap for them. Love speaks powerfully. Love is action. Love never fails. My second habit I want to address is making people like you. It's not about being a people pleaser. It's about understanding who you are and in that authenticness of just the uniqueness of how you're made, allowing God to use that to be a blessing to other people. So let's not suggest that you rearrange your attitude, rearrange your life to make people like you, but you should be aware of the impact of your actions and your behaviors on others. Just as I mentioned at the beginning, you are an influencer, and to be that influencer for good and not evil. So as you make people like you, I find that it helps when you are putting their interests before you, or as we talk in a minute, are complimentary, and as you focus on what you share in common rather than, you know, what you don't have in common. But it's about like Romans 12:10 reminds us, be devoted to each other like a loving family. And in that, excel in showing respect for each other. When you're at this place, when a heart that's not about pressing and insisting and driving, but when it's about a conversation to get what you need done, but enjoy the journey along the way, I'll tell you what, it's sure a lot more fun. When you have people that are just feeling valued, and in the moment you're taking time. I know my mother, I learned so much from her growing up. She, even then, had this gift of talking on the phone. And as her husband will tell you, to this day, she still enjoys that gift of talking on the phone. But I've watched how she flows with it. When she calls that person, she asks how they're doing. She allows them now she has a purpose for this call, but she allows them to talk about what they need, to get off their heart. And then ultimately with the master craftsman, she is navigating that conversation to get to kind of the reason for the call at that moment. And she might ask for a favor, or she might invite them to a meeting that she will be hosting in her home. But in that, in that process of conversation, she's allowing for the flow, not to be rushed or pressed, but to have and to run its full course. And then it's amazing how that there's like that pause in the conversation. And you know it's time now to ask the question, the ask that really you need to have done and complete then. My job, since it's so much either on Zoom or it's about phone calls, I work in a national office that has an international presence. And connecting, God had kind of awakened me last night before I had just finished my lesson. I was getting ready for bed. I had done some time, had spent some time with God in prayer. And he reminded me, you need to check your emails again. Now, I had checked them on Saturday for work, but something said, no, you need to really check them. And sure enough, there was an email for a Zoom meeting this morning, and the individual apologized for the late notice. That meant I needed to email a lot of people to invite them to participate in this Zoom experience. So where do you go? Well, one, I'm tired. One, I just don't want to, I just really want to get to bed. And now I've signed up for this early morning Zoom call and it's already late. But one thing about the power of divine favor, of influence, it's about faithfulness. So what did I do? I got the email. I started writing out, typing out what needed to be done. And I checked it a couple times, knowing the late hour. But what was wonderful to me was the outpouring of individuals who signed up for this last minute Zoom meeting and was able to see the value. Because why? That's divine favor. When you flow at that place, when you're seeking God and allowing Him to be the center of your life, He, and I love how this one translation declares in Proverbs, He will crown your efforts with success. That influence that's yours in Christ, He will open up amazing doors and opportunities, and He will bring the increase, right? We might plant, we might water, but God does the increase. He prospers and He blesses the works of our hands. So flow, my friend, in that power of influence. And let's give a shout out to Pat Dinkins, who is moderating today, Tammy Franklin, Ann Sellers. Give them a shout out. Let them know that you're there, you're listening. Let them know that what you're feeling. Are you connecting with what we're talking about, what they're typing in the chat? Build a connection. Sometimes you might be thinking, well, where do I begin? Hey, you can begin right now. You begin by just stepping out and just having a conversation, knowing that you are an influencer. I think the big thing is just knowing who you are in Christ and flowing in that that realized truth. So making people like you, it's about flowing in this love and in this place of just being yourself, being authentic, being helpful, seeking and really putting others before you. And the best rule of thumb, listen to this, the best rule of thumb is just be yourself. Be who you are, but allow God's Spirit, the very fruit that that Spirit brings. I love how one translation says that when you allow the Holy Spirit to control you, He produces this fruit in us of love and joy and peace and patience. You know, when you allow the very fruit, the very life of God that's living in you, you can be your true self, but it's your true self and planted and grounded in Him. So what are they seeing? They're seeing the very life, the very fullness of God in you. People, there's going to be a connection because God has sent us in that great commission into all the world and have that impact. And we can only do that when we understand the influence, the favor that is ours in Christ. So seek in any given moment, be purposeful and intentional to be kind, knowing that faith works by love, choosing to be helpful, putting the interest of others before yourself, and to be authentic, to be true to who God created you to be. And develop that habit of noticing common experiences and interests and backgrounds of other people. You have the help of the Holy Spirit. He'll bring it to your mind. When I found out that the judge had been here, or she was on vacation, I said, oh, really? And she said, well, not really vacation. My son just had his second child. And so in that conversation and dialogue, we were able to have a greater depth of connection. But it's one of listening and allowing the Holy Spirit to use that as a way to get to know that person. You know, I miss seeing many of you that I used to see in person all the time. So how do I do it now? Well, I'm thankful that we can text back and forth. I'm thankful I can read these comments that you're writing later, and I feel like we've connected, even though we haven't physically been there. You know, with God, I love that there is no difference with whether we're in person or whether we're miles apart, like the centurion who said, just say the word. I know my servant will be healed. We have the very life that we can speak out of our mouth that can cause shifts to the circumstances around us. And we don't even have to physically be there. So COVID, hey, bring it on. We might have a little more time that we have to be quarantined, but not too much longer, thanks be to God. But in the meantime, we will make the most of the season and time, knowing that there's no limit with what God can do, that we're not limited by what we can physically see. We have an unseen God that says what is unseen is more real than what we see. And our words, they are a creative force, and they can bring life when there was nothing there. So my next point is this: be generous with your approval, your appreciation, and even acknowledgments. So when you focus on just those common areas in which you have similarities, the influence will grow. When you then compliment that individual, when you take time to be generous in your approval, let me tell you, they're much more productive. I think of my grandkids, when I tell them what a great job they're doing, my goodness, it's like they become, you know, the Energizer Bunny. They want to do it some more. We'll be outside picking up the trash, and they're like, oh, Gigi, look, my bag's this full now. Compliments. It does something. Approval, appreciation, acknowledgments. We know that Proverbs 12:25 says anxious hearts, they can be very heavy, but a word of encouragement does wonders. If it can do that for a heavy heart, how much more can those words of encouragement motivate and fortify an individual to take on new challenges, whatever that might be? Giving approval in the form of compliments, affirmations, acknowledgement, it builds the bonds that will strengthen and fortify your influence. God wants us to think and fix our mind on things that we can give God praise for. And how much more He wants us to do that in the relationships we're with. Have you ever been around somebody that's a downer, where everything's awful? Everything just couldn't have been more worse. Who wants to be around that? But when you're optimistic, when you're encouraging, when you're looking at the, you know, a God that with Him all things are possible, let me tell you, people want to be around that kind of influence, that kind of impact. And so for you and me, we want to have the impact. And to do so, we are going to be optimistic. So if you want to increase your influence, praise the good that you see in people. Compliment them. Notice what they do well. Be sincere. Don't flatter. And remember, over-focusing on the differences, it narrows your influence. But when you focus on those commonalities, your influence will grow. And finally, let me wrap up in this with favor. That is, have you ever had the good fortune that might come your way, but you can't explain why it came, or perhaps even how? That unmerited favor is a God who promises that, like it says in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, if you want favor with God and man, if you want a reputation of good judgment and common sense, then trust the Lord completely. Don't trust in yourself. In everything you do, put God first, and He will direct you. He will crown your efforts with success. Favor doesn't require you to be perfect. Like I said earlier, you just need to be faithful. Favor can give you influence when it seems you shouldn't have any at all. Favor's not about titles or position. It's about knowing you have a God who is your drive, who is your your divine influencer that's working in and through you in the hearts and lives of those around. He has a purpose for you. And in the marketplace of our life, whether it's in the workplace, in our community, in our family and church, he wants us to be able to use our gifts, fulfill our purpose, and flow in that passion. Favor can cause people to lean your way and to listen when logic says there's someone that has more expertise. But favor, it can promote you to that position when you didn't even hold the qualifications for the job that you're called for. Favor will cause people to like you and elevate you and place you in positions of higher influence. Ask for it. God says, ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be open. I declare that those of you that are watching today, it's a new day dawning. God's wanting you to step out of the boat. He wants you to try some things you haven't done before, but his Spirit's been stirring and awakening and giving you the unction to try this and reminding you you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Why? Because you have the power of divine favor operating in and through you. You have a God who's making a way. You have ministering spirits that are there alongside to help you in your journey of life. And regardless of just the setbacks, know that God can use all things for good, and he will work them as you keep your heart and your trust on him. God bless you all. We've got some great things. We've got a Thursday mini. End of this month, we got game time. Come on now. Haven't signed up? Go to our website, www.cindydennis.org, to sign up and find out the details. And for those of you that are just wanting to get involved, hey, give us a shout out. Chat it up and let us know how we can pray with you, how we can join our faith with yours to see God move and propel you in that season that he has for you. Good night, everyone. Thanks for joining us. God bless you.